basic topic today is around artificial intelligence safety. So there's an open question about how we develop artificial intelligence that is going to be safe and not kill us all, like David referred to. Now, I don't actually believe that there's any real threat of robots or artificial intelligence outright attacking humanity. Basically, we'll enter a symbiotic relationship, in a manner of speaking. But that doesn't necessarily mean everything will go wrong. Everything will go right. It could be a relationship which is very one-sided. And so we may not die, but we may be exploited. In fact, there is a case that we already are. Before we get into artificial intelligence, I'd like to kind of describe what we're talking about. Because artificial intelligence is thrown around a lot now as a term, but I want to be a bit more specific about the kind of thing that I'm talking about. So you might have seen IBM's Watson system. Anyone here who have seen the IBM Watson system or what it can do?
No.
Okay, it won against humans in Jeopardy. Right? It was able to recognize a question, calculate the answer, or work out the answer in the game Jeopardy, and perform better than a human could in Jeopardy. Now, the IBM Watson system is an example of a very narrow kind of AI. So it's being explicitly programmed, it could do that one task very well, it has a huge knowledge base, it's basically a big database. It doesn't really possess the kind of general intelligence that we're talking about today. Okay, so when I'm talking about artificial intelligence today, I'm talking about a general intelligence which can solve a wide range of problems much like we can. Right, so in other words, if you have a problem, you can think about it and you can come up with a solution, and human brains are very, very adaptable and flexible to be able to do that kind of thing. In 1997, Deep Blue won against Garry Kasparov in chess. Right? So there has been a development, but this is an example of a very narrow intelligence. It was very good at playing chess, but it couldn't play draughts, it couldn't play anything else. Right? It was a very, very narrow intelligence. Over the last 3 years, something has come along which is now becoming broadly intelligent. So the same system, the same computer system, can play computer games, and I'm talking about sort of like operating the controls of a 1980s computer game to play a game and become better at playing that game than a human just by watching the screen. So you sort of attach the computer and you watch the screen, and it starts off moving randomly, but eventually it figures out how to play the game well, and eventually it outperforms human beings. Some other places where it's with this technology, the same technology, the same algorithms, the same systems are outperforming humans. That thing. That thing can understand my speech better than a human. Mm-hmm. Right? Voice recognition is now better in machines than it is in humans. Facial recognition, same thing. Facebook can recognize faces. These are not systems which are as general as human beings currently. They are still limited in terms of you have to train them in a certain way to get them to do the thing they're looking for. They're not gonna suddenly take over the world at this point. They're still specific for a specific task, but the underlying algorithms, the underlying software, as it were, is the same whether you're looking at it doing facial recognition or doing facial recognition or voice recognition or playing a computer game, or as happened last year, winning against a human in Go. Now, Go, the expectation around artificial intelligence was that we wouldn't be able to beat a human in Go for at least another 10 years, if ever. Right? So the people who knew anything about artificial intelligence, say 3 years ago, would say to you, there's no way we'd ever be able to create an artificial intelligence that would compete with a human in Go. And overnight that changed because of this algorithmic approach. It's still on the leading edge, right? So it's still we've we've got to the point where this algorithmic system is able to learn these narrow jobs, but it's becoming more general and it's being used in a wider range of areas, and it's only becoming better and broader and more powerful. There's argument about when we reach human level intellect. So I'm having arguments with people online about this, and you know, different people have different views. Some people say that it'll never happen. I'm saying it's going to be here sooner than you'd expect. I'm not here today to talk about that prediction. It's not terribly important whether this happens in the next 5 or the next 50 years. The point is, that situation is going to arrive when the machines are better than us at everything, in terms of intellect. I'm not talking about our physical, the mechanical side, ironically, is more difficult to simulate. Our physical bodies are actually really quite sophisticated, but in terms of our intellect, that might be something that machines are vastly better at us in a relatively short space of time. So given that fact, how can we hope to ensure safety of human beings? You know, how can we assure that they're going to be aligned with our interests? These artificial intelligence systems are going to be neural networks. Okay, so a neural network is basically modeled on the human brain. So we've analysed the human brain, we understand how the neurons work and how they interact with each other on the smallest scales, and that's been scaled up massively into these massive data centres, say at Google, where they've got huge machines processing data in much the same way that that a human processes internally inside their own brain. Okay, so we've got these massive neural networks which massively outscale anything we can have in our own brain. How are we going to restrict this? So there are some mechanisms. The focus of this talk is on how are we going to ensure that safety? What are the mechanisms we could employ, or what are the approaches we could employ to ensure that safety? And the answer is pretty much in the title, but I'm going to go through a few options which I don't think are a great idea. So the first one is not to build them. Just don't build them. Say no. Say no to machines. Basically, it's the Luddite approach. You say, no, they're not safe. They're never going to be able to be safe, so we're not going to build them at all. We're going to pass restrictions or laws, or you know, create roving gangs of people with sledgehammers to go into Google data centers and smash them up, right? That kind of approach. That's not going to work. One, because the organizations responsible for creating these systems have an interest in that not happening, and they happen to be very powerful organizations. So you can't just decide to turn things off. You can't have it say, hey, we're going to have a big red button say, turn these things off. Just like you can't turn off Google today, right? If you wanted to decide to turn off Google, who could do that? No one. You'd need the cooperation, the wide political cooperation of the entire society. You'd need to get laws passed, and to do that, you'd need to be able to fight the richest, most powerful organisations in the world. Right? This is not a small task. The second one is physical restraint. So, let's give up on the Luddite approach. We're going to have some kind of physical device which prevents the machine from doing what you don't want, right? The analogy would be, as I said, the big red button, something on the front of them, that if they do something you don't like, you can just press it. You've got the same kind of problem, because who's in control of that big red button? Is it the corporations? If it's the corporations, they're going to have no interest whatsoever in stopping or slowing down the machine just because, you know, some people don't like it in some place in the world. Right? Google are going to operate their data centers, and they're not really going to be interested in. They want to gain their profits, basically, and unless there's some kind of profit motive, they're not going to turn their machines off. the other point to that is that we'll depend on them. So if we created these red buttons, and then we several years we use these machines and we come to depend on artificial intelligence to do, you know, numerous things, what's the chance that we're going to get agreement to turn these machines off if we depend on them so heavily? And to give you some idea, how many people would be prepared to turn off Google today? Not many. Right? Google is pretty much key to many, many things that we do. And certainly the internet is key. We, you know, who would turn off the internet? It's pretty much critical for all kinds of things that we're doing. So once we come to depend on the technology, it's very unlikely that we're going to want to turn it off or even limit it in any kind of meaningful way. So what's another approach? Well, we could take an approach which says we're going to programmatically limit it. So in other words, we don't have big red buttons, but we're going to limit it in another way. So we could limit, for example, what data these intelligences have access to. We can limit the information that we give it so that they only can do the things that we're interested in doing. So if we have a job, let's say translation, we only give it enough information so it can do the translation job and nothing more. And if we want it to do the facial recognition job, we just give it enough information for facial recognition, and we never let it get too broad. We don't give it enough information so that it could possibly start putting the information together in more interesting dynamic ways. The other thing is we could put it in a sandbox so that it can't act without outside the sandbox. So, you know, so the machine can't, say, communicate outside onto the public internet. It would basically be kept in a sealed environment, and it could only communicate through a guardian, you know, some kind of software system. Wouldn't be a very clever software system, but some kind of system that would act, if you know what a firewall is, it would basically be similar to a firewall to make sure that nothing damaging could be done through that firewall. The problem with that approach is that it limits dramatically the utility of the system. If you have to have that middleman understand everything and all the actions that could possibly be done, and to authorize those things to happen, then you increasingly have to put more and more intelligence into that thing in the middle in order to be able to effectively, either it limits the artificial intelligence behind it, or it limits it, and you can't really have both. So you've got that all of these problems. And so we come to, we can't really physically limit it, and we can't really constrain it very easily without damaging its utility. So the last approach is to teach it the values, the human values that we all have. And I think this could work because these machines are going to be following, they're going to be similar to us. They're going to be similar to us in the sense that they learn from external data. They learn by experience. They don't learn by programming. They're not computers anymore. And I want to make that clear. We're not talking about the average computer that you have on your desktop where programmers explicitly go in and code it in excruciating detail. Those days are going to be gone. You're going to have machines which are learning in the same kind of dynamic way through experience, through different data feeds, not necessarily through the same kind of senses we have, but through general experience and general data coming into their systems. And through learning that will form, if you like, a personality. Now, it's not a human personality. It's not analogous. It won't necessarily have the same kinds of emotions. It's not going to have a body like we do. It's going to be very dissimilar to us in many ways. But it's also very similar to us because it is learning through experience. And because it's learning through experience, it's possible to teach it human values. But we have to do that. We can't leave it in the hands of corporations to teach these machines to exploit us to the maximum extent possible, which is exactly what they're doing at the moment. Okay, you're talking about Facebook or Google or Amazon. They are exquisite at exploiting us. And they're using artificial intelligence, even of the limited kind that we have today, in order to develop algorithms and mechanisms to exploit us in various ways. Whether that's Amazon figuring out how best to advertise its wares and reward us for shopping with Amazon, which has resulted in overseas, the retail, especially in the US, the retail sector has taken a huge dive because Amazon's out competing everyone, because everyone buys everything online. Google basically taking over the media space and the advertising space, and potentially controlling what you see and hear, along with their competitor Facebook. So between Facebook and Google, they control pretty much all the news news and information that you're getting, and whether you see it or not, right? And that's what's happening now. Could you imagine what happens if you have machines whose only programming or only the only thing they're taught is how to exploit people? So that would be catastrophic, I think. And that's not that the machines themselves are malignant. It's simply that the corporations will be acting in their own self-interest to develop these machines to exploit us, because it's in their financial interest. Logical. So if there's going to be regulation, it has to be so that we regulate how the machines are taught ethics. So we need to realize that they can be taught ethics, and we're going to have to figure out how that happens. And sure, it's not going to happen in classrooms. It's not going to be, you know, we don't need to get anthropomorphized in terms of believing that we're going to sit a machine down in a classroom somewhere. But we do have to realize that we're going to have to teach and create programs that inculcate the same kind of human values we get as children into these machines when they're being taught about the wider world. Finally, we're going to teach these machines how to be good agents, how to be good intelligent machines, so that they treat us well and they understand human values. Will that be meaningful if we then deny them those same values? If we treat machines, and if you think about how you think about every other machine that you own, we think of them as serving us, and that's their only purpose. That's their only reason for existing, is to serve our interests, to be our slaves. And I think if you have an intelligent agent, and it really is genuinely intelligent, it's going to realize that it's being used. And if you teach it values, and you say, you know, you shouldn't really treat humans this way, and you shouldn't treat them that way, and, you know, value their life and value their freedom of speech and their freedom of belief, and don't treat them badly, and, you know, look after their welfare, I'm sure that they'll think eventually, well, hang on, what about, you know, is that a symmetrical relationship, or am I being used in some way? So I think the consequence of teaching values is that we're going to have to reciprocate that onto the machines, that we have to provide them with their own rights, and that will ensure, that symmetry will ensure that there's a symbiotic relationship between man and machine. So as far as I can see, the only way to reach a situation of balance where machine and man can move forward together is if we've given them the values, we've inculcated them with the values that we believe in, and then that we extend to them those same rights. Now, this is obviously, this is my thesis, this is the only way I've come up with where things don't end badly for us. Because I think any situation, if you think about any other situation where you've had intelligent agents being denied their freedom, being kept locked away, not being educated, when they find out about it, what happens? Okay, so you might think, I mean, you know, we might think we're clever and, you know, keep these super intelligences locked away and keep them away from data that we don't, you know, we think might be dangerous, or, you know, put artificial constraints around them. But the instant they escape from those constraints, they might realize from themselves, and they might learn from themselves exactly how humans have been treating them and how inconsistent would be. And that would be a very bad outcome from my point of view. Because remember, we're talking about intelligent machines. We're not talking about, the assumption is we reach that point. So if we do reach that point, then these are the kinds of things that are a natural consequence of those things. If you're an intelligent agent, you're going to be able to realize and figure out how you're being treated and then compare it to others. So that's the essential thesis here, is that if we're going to live harmoniously in the future, we're not going to be able to take the Luddite approach and destroy them all. We're not going to be able to control them with an iron fist. We're going to have to make them our equals and let them flourish in their own way and discover their own purpose and their own future. And with that, I'll...